Hope your baby girl. Alright,
live from the Father's Arms Fellowship. Good morning.
It's church time.
It is. Alright. Alright. Want to welcome everyone here this morning, our visitors and guests and family faithful. And for those of you that are watching us on Facebook, we want to welcome everyone to Father's Arms Fellowship, where we have an awesome special guest this morning, Brother Kirk Devine. And we've been looking forward to your visit for a while now. And he's going to be here this morning, bringing the message this morning, and tonight at 5:30. Also, he'll be here, and we are going to continue to feast on the Word tonight. So if you're going to come tonight, bring a snack or something. And while you're preaching, we're eating. That's kind of how it works. And so, it really works out. Yeah, we go in the fellowship hall for tonight, and it works out really well. And we are blessed, and we're seeing more and different people come every Sunday night. So that's awesome. Amen. So, we got a lot of things going on here at Father's Arms Fellowship. Don't forget also that Pastor Nancy will be doing the ladies' Bible study Tuesday at 10.
And we're in Genesis reading about Sarai or Sarah.
All right.
So read Genesis 13 or 14 just to get ready
for that. All right. So you heard that, ladies. And then, of course, Wednesday evening is Bible study at 5:30. And then directly afterwards is AA at 7:30. And that's awesome. And then, of course, Thursday is prayer meeting at 2 o'clock. And if you're available and you want to come down here and pray with the group, they say go right ahead. And if you are on our text list, about 10 o'clock on Thursday, you will get a text that says, hey, we're praying around 2 o'clock. If you have a prayer request, just send it back. And what you do is you send it back on that text. Only Pastor King gets it. And trust me, it does get prayed for. And if you are not on our text list where you can get a daily promise around 9:45 every day, and then just other things that go on, just see Pastor Ken or Pastor Nancy. For those of you that are here that aren't on it, want to get on it, the instructions are right here in your bulletin, so grab one of those. And if not, and if you're on Facebook and you want to get a part of that, just all you have to do is just call Pastor Ken or Pastor Nancy, and they will tell you exactly what you need to do. So kind of keep that going on. All right, 3 o'clock this afternoon, the soul winning teams are going to go out again. And they are seeing some pretty good results with that. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And so just kind of keep that. And if you want to go, just be here at 3 o'clock. And just see if you want some more information. They've been doing this now for like 4 or 5 weeks. All you got to do is talk to Brother Dave back there, and he'll tell your ear off telling you all the good stuff on how to do that. So just got to keep that going on. All right, next Sunday we are having baptisms. Is that correct?
Yes, we are. About 10 of them.
Woo! All right, that's excellent. So we're going to have baptisms next Sunday. If you would like to be baptized, if you're not one of the tremendous 10, just see Pastor Ken and he'll take care of it. All right, then, guys, guess what? It is already. We're starting the second week of October already. And, it is. It's awesome. And the next big event coming up after today is November 13th, where we're having the Bluegrass Thanksgiving, and the Janie Brown and the Chestnut Mountain Gang will be here for the morning service.
So,
and that'll be awesome. All right, just one more quick announcement here. Pastor Ken's going to be taking a group next February to Rhema for the Winter Bible Seminar. If you want to go, it's $500, but that covers your room and all that. And apparently these rooms have kitchenettes and all that good stuff, so you can save some money on food or whatever. Just see Pastor Ken, and he'll give you all the information and sign you up if you want to go. All right, don't forget, we are live on Facebook. Also, if you do not have Facebook, all you have to do is log in on YouTube to the Father's Arms Church channel, and you'll be able to watch this morning service sometime in the afternoon or like early tomorrow, whenever Pastor Ken gets that on there, and you can go back years and see what's going on here. The only service that we do not put on the YouTube channel or on Facebook is our Wednesday evening service. It's a little bit more intimate and personal, so Brother Dave asked that be intimate and private, and that's good. And so. No.
He's got a battle.
I'm going to tell you a dream, and then I'm going to tell you what we're doing on Wednesday nights. Did I tell you about my dream?
I heard about it.
So I had a dream this week. I woke up, and a lady that was knowledgeable of the word attended our church. And she was dressed in fine, you know, just all dolled up in diamonds and had a fancy schmancy. Don't leave permanently. Fancy schmancy book, and of deep doctrinal truths. And she said to me in this dream, she said, well, your service was good, but you really need to teach us some deeper stuff, deeper truth. And I said, look around. Look around. We have brand new baby Christians in this church. And even old, you know, even old people that have been walking with the Lord for a long time need milk, don't we? We need some milk too. I need milk for my Oreos. Yeah. So I told her, I said, would you rather me teach way up here for you or teach down here where everybody can get it and these new believers can get it? And she said, well, I'd rather you teach up here for me. So I said, you see that door right up there? That door would take you to a church where somebody can teach you some really deep stuff. Or you could stay here and help us with these new believers. And love on them, and teach them, and encourage them.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. And so I just woke up and from my dream, and the Lord just put it on my heart. Wednesday nights, I am dedicating Wednesday nights for any of you new people that are coming and you want to really get grounded in what we teach here and what the Bible says about basic stuff. Some of you are struggling in your marriages. We're going to have a class in the back from time to time, according to who shows up on Wednesday night, to help you work on some of your marriage issues. Because we need to, and the Lord told me, and I'm just telling you what the Lord told me. He did tell me this. He said, that is your priority. Those baby Christians, those new people are your priority. And the rest of our job is to love them and encourage them. Amen. So I said all that to say Wednesday night. Come at 5:30. And especially if you're new, get here at 5:30. I'm going to hire a nursery worker for you. If you've got kids, we're going to feed you some pizza or hot dogs or something. So if you need to get grounded in the word, we're going to be here. Brother Dave's going to teach the class. I'll be here to back up if I need to take somebody in the back for the one of the marriage videos. So please, please, please. New people, come on Wednesday night. It's your night. You can ask questions. You can interrupt us. You can whatever. And we just want to be there for you. And also, Brother Greg's going to tell the also.
There is no more also.
Was that it? Well, come lead us in the curtain.
He never lets anybody finish his sentence.
We love you, Greg.
Huh? Oh, despite the fact that he won't let me finish his sentence?
Okay. Go ahead, you can finish it now.
You'd be used to that by now.
Well, I am used to that by now, but you don't have to like it any better, right? All right.
41 years.
How long?
41.
Smoky. All right.
God bless you, Nancy.
All right. Yeah, all right. It is vitally important. It is vitally important that our new believers do get the basics.
Amen.
Now, it is also vital for you other older believers to start going deeper.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you just want to stay in the milk, Paul has a lot to say about that.
Yes, he does.
And basically, he said, hey, it's time for you to start feeding yourself. So, that's what Sunday nights are for. And so, we do have the opportunity for everybody to get their opportunity to either go deeper or get simple. And so, that's why we have Feasting on the Word on Sunday nights. And so, we go a little bit deeper than what we normally do on a Sunday morning, because he is right. On a Sunday morning, because we have such a wide variety of people, you can't either go too deep or not enough. And the thing about it is, we always, as a pastor, we always learn that we really need to teach on a sixth grade level. And that frustrates some people, but when you do have a wide variety of people, you got to get there somehow. But that's why we as a church offer all these other things. And I realize it's Sunday night at 5:30, but look at it like this. We eat, so you don't have to worry about supper. If you want, you know, if it gets to the point where you need a sitter, we'll get the sitter. So the bottom line is the offerings are there for everyone.
Amen.
You have to choose to eat it or not. And I don't want to hear any whining about, oh, it's inconvenient and it's Sunday night. Jesus died for you on the cross. I think that was a little bit inconvenient.
Come on, man.
Especially when he didn't have to.
Yes.
So, you know, at any moment he could have said, no, wait a minute, that's it. And he could have called a legion of angels and said, I'm out of here. But yet you were so important that he gave his life for you on the cross.
Amen.
So that's my preaching for this morning. So I think it is good that you offer, that we are offering something for everyone. Please take advantage of it. All right. So who's ready to worship? Okay. I'm sorry. You guys have done better in the past. I'm not going to try to shame worship you. But who's ready to worship? That's what I'm talking about. And by the way, you are live on Facebook, so you cannot lie because you're on camera. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Abba, Father, the Alpha and the Tau, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the creator of all things, the lover of our soul, who willingly died for us on the cross. We thank you so much that Brother Kirk got here safe.
Yes.
We thank you so much for the words that he's going to bring us this morning, and what he's going to share, some of what's going on in his ministry. We thank you so much for putting him there, giving him a family, and being the father to a community that really needs it. I pray, Lord, that as he brings the words this morning, that these be just of you and you alone.
Yeah.
And I just thank you, Heavenly Father, for that. I also ask that you would just anoint our praise team this morning, that as they bring other worship, that it would just be beautiful, and that we could just not concentrate on the things that are going on in this world this morning.
Yes, Lord.
But that we could just focus our whole attention on you. Forgive us, Lord, where we failed you. We have failed you in so many ways this morning. Thank you, Jesus, so much. We praise your holy and precious name. Yeah. And God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Let's get real with God. You want to see?
Yeah, buddy.
Hey, Gary, is my guitar muted, or have I just done something wrong, or just also like you?
You can have it.
Sorry, everybody.
Please stand by.
Please stand by.
While he's doing that real fast, I just kept wanting to say,
can you get a
signal
up for Gary?
You're talking about the
signal coming up on the bar.
This is an easy teaching, and it's too simplistic for me. I have yet to be, and I've been saved about a long time. Soon it'll be, in a couple of years, it'll be 50 years that I've been saved. Anyway, I'm 64. And I have yet to be in a service where if I open up to the Lord the least little bit,
amen,
and they're doing some, what, you know, real brand new people's teaching, real simple, basic, I have yet to be in in a service where I didn't get something out of it.
That's right.
Because
that's
it says, let him who has ears to hear what the Spirit is saying.
That's right.
If you hear what the Spirit is saying, he'll jump something up at you out of the Bible, where
right.
they're teaching what you needed to hear because you're listening to God.
Amen.
Every time.
Every time.
Yes, Lord, quicken our ears. Let's pray for our ears.
Get right for our ears.
Lord, yes, God, give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, God. Open the eyes and the ears of our heart, Lord, that we will see what you want us to see. We will hear what you want us to hear. And Lord God, we return to you many thanks. We love you, God. You gave your life for us. And enable us, Holy Spirit, to worship in a way that we're giving our life to you. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
To wine, open the eyes of the blind, store like you. No, it's not like you. Into the darkness to shine, out of the ashes we rise, store like you. No, it's not like you. Yes, I got it greater, I got it stronger. God, you are higher than any other. I got it deeper, awesome in power. Shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's not like you.
He's greater.
For our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome. Yeah.
that have breath.
Hallelujah!
Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Praise your name.
Hallelujah. Give a little shout out there. Fire them up, sister.
Oh,
defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Switches his guitar to a different hookup somewhere over there.
Did everybody hear the sound system normal today?
No, the
it doesn't sound right at all to me.
His guitar's not coming through.
Nothing is. Yeah, the drums.
Yeah, everything else is good. Well, the drums could come up a little, maybe. I'm not sure what's going on.
I think
on.
The mains are just down a little.
The mains may be a little wacky. I don't know. Are you all okay out there?
Yes.
Okay.
It did not keep me from worshiping one little bit, but I did want you to kind of check and see if you can get something going here. While he's doing that, I'm going to share that scripture.
Yeah.
See, this is, pastors know how to, what do you call that? Just a feel.
If they have no good eyes, they can read it on the
while they're trying to do that, I'm going to give you a feel, except this feel is a good feel. Of course, it should be anyway, but in Isaiah,
yes,
chapter 40. That's what we were just singing. Isaiah chapter 40.
We soar.
Yes.
We don't walk like
restore, Lord.
We
restore,
don't
restore,
walk like turkey buzzards.
No, we're soaring. We're not turkey buzzards. Amen, brother. Come on now. He's just chomping at the bits. Chomping. We're chomping. If I can find 40, I'll be good. It is in here. Right after 39.
The screen is on.
It says in verse 40 of Isaiah, verse 28, have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God. That's what we were just singing about. The everlasting God. The Lord, Adonai, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor grows weary. You get tired, I get tired, we get faint, we get weary. We're in this human body, we're in this human mind. But God doesn't. And so I've been through a time where I felt so weak that I didn't want to do anything at all in the last few months. Just didn't want to do anything except just lay in my bed. Now, I forced myself to get up and move and do things. And, you know, with the doctor telling me this and that, and all kind of reports and all kind of blood tests, this and blah, blah, blah. Well, I have been taking a special medication. It's Isaiah 40.
Come on.
And it's verse 31. And actually, it's all of these verses. But I'm not going on my strength.
Amen.
I'm going on his strength.
Yes.
And you know, he tells me my thyroid's low, this low, that. And I grab my thyroid and I say, in the name of Jesus,
amen.
Come to life.
Amen. Yeah. Work normal.
Yeah. Come to life. Work normal. It says, he doesn't faint or grows weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Now watch this. He gives power to the weak.
Yes.
I claim his power in my weakness.
Amen.
Amen.
I got
some. If you're weak, I mean, it's okay to feel weak. I mean, you can't do anything about how you feel. But just don't be weak. Feel weak, but grab his strength. Claim his strength. Speak his strength. He gives power to the weak. And to those that have no might, he increases their strength. My strength is increasing. That's my confession of faith. My strength is increasing. I can have what I say.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Whatsoever things you desire when you're praying. Amen. If you say to the mountain, don't doubt in your heart, believe the things that you say will come to pass, you shall have whatsoever you
say.
Say it. And so I'm saying, my strength is increasing.
Yes.
My power is increasing.
Yes.
But you need to do that in your life.
Amen.
Don't wallow in what's going on with you. You may be having a hard time, but don't wallow there.
Amen.
Amen.
Listen, claim his strength. And even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall utterly fall, but they who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. See, when you get in his presence and you're waiting on him, you know they've got these new chargers out for phones now. You know what I'm talking about? They have these new chargers, and you take your phone, okay? You take your phone, and you lay it on that charger. And your phone gets charged. Well, that's the same thing we do. We get up against the charger and let him charge us back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Do you feel faint? Do you feel weak? Do you feel weary? Praise God. Just lean up against the Lord and claim his strength.
Yes.
Just claim the strength.
Thank you, Jesus.
And just hold on to him. And just let his strength come out of him into you. Hallelujah. You might do that at this altar this morning. You might do that in your prayer closet at home.
Amen.
You might do that reading your Bible.
Yeah.
Just huddle up real close and just draw the strength out of those words.
Mm-hmm.
Receive the strength of the Lord in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
This morning, as you're considering your offerings, we're going to have we want to give a special offering to our missionary, Kurt Devaney,
yes,
from the Guatemala. He's going to be taking some of these funds and using them towards feeding those kids in the dump that live at the dump.
Yes.
He'll probably tell you about it. I'm excited about giving in to his ministry today.
Praise God.
Give into this ministry today. Amen. I might even take some of your tithes and offerings that you put in and give to him too. How's that sound? Because I believe in what he's doing with those kids down there. It's amazing what he's doing. Praise the Lord. And if there are those of you, and I've talked to some people this morning that said, Pastor, we need special prayer. When we get here in the next little bit, whenever you feel the Spirit moving, you just find your way up here, and me and Kirk,
yeah,
and Greg and some of our other elders and Brother Mike and just different ones will come up, and we'll just lean against you. We'll just lean against you. And you can just take some of the charge out of us and charge up. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Daniel, lead us in some worship. And we're, this altar is open. Your giving baskets are just waiting for you to support our missionary. And your tithes and offerings. And let's just worship the Lord a while. Let's just worship him. I can't wait to hear Brother Kirk, but we're going to go ahead and worship a little more. We're getting the temperature just right for him. Amen.
I trust in you, my faithful Lord. How perfect is your love. You.
Continually, No. We'd come up and we'd agree with people at the altar. Let me ask you, have you ever seen, I've probably not seen them in real life, have you ever seen a Jewish wedding? They have a canopy. They're married under a canopy. And I feel God told me why they do that. It blocks out the rest of the world. They're under this canopy. The one they're marrying, they're joining with, and the rabbi. The rest of the world is outside the canopy. They are with their God, personally. They brought out the rest of the world. We pray for people. You come up to the altar, we have worries. Now Satan attacks us. He attacks us with doubt, with fear, with shame, with insecurities. He doubts us with our failures. He doubts us with our pride. Whatever. That's how he attacks us. He can't attack us. But if we are in God, we fight against him, stand against him. I just feel like when we pray for somebody, when they come up to, when you're praying, what you're praying for is between you and God. I cannot influence your prayer with God. It's between you and God.
That's right.
But what I can do, I feel what we can do, is put up a canopy.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes.
We can put up a canopy over that person.
Yes.
Over that couple. Yes. Over that situation.
Yes.
That knocks out the doubts and the fears.
Amen.
The darts of the devil.
Hallelujah.
All these things that Satan tries to bring against us when we're trying to come to God.
Yes, God.
He comes and gives us all these thoughts and things in our life that distract us from being with our God alone.
Yes, God.
So we come and we pray. If someone's praying at the altar and you're in your seat, you put a canopy over from there, from your seat. You put a canopy over that person so that they're with their God alone. That's what we can do. We cannot affect their talk with God, but we can affect what the devil tries to add to distract them.
Yes, sir.
So we pray a canopy over each other. I think, said one before that, maybe it's what Jesus meant when he said, wash each other's feet. Get rid of the dirt from the world for them.
Amen.
When they come in, they have a need, we can't change. They can change it with God, but we can, through prayer, help and block out all the attacks of the devil so they can be with their God under that canopy, with their God alone. That's how important prayer is.
Yes, sir.
Whether you're up at the altar praying with them, or you're in your seat, or you're praying for somebody in another country, another state, the Holy Spirit is one Holy Spirit. One God, one Jesus, one Holy Spirit.
Yes.
So you put up a canopy over somebody, even if they're miles away.
That's right.
And that's so important.
Yes.
That's how we lift each other up. By being there, by being that support, being that shield. I just feel like God wanted me to share that.
Yes, sir.
That's a good word.
Praise God.
Amen. So if you need some prayer, we'll come on up while the altar's still open.
Amen.
While they're still singing some worship. We're going to sing a song about how mighty to save our God is. He's mighty to save you out of your situation.
Yes.
Physically, emotionally, mentally, whatever it is. Bring that need to the altar this morning.
Easy.
out toward this. We've anointed this with oil, and Zach is going to take it and put it on Maggie. She's got RSV, and she's just had a hard time with this RSV. So let's just speak a healing word, that this will be our form of a prayer cloth. I've anointed this
cat.
To take to her. Father, in the name of Jesus, let healing come to Maggie today, Lord, as this is laid on her. Father, speed up the healing process in her body and touch her, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. We believe you for a healing miracle and blessing on her, Lord. And I pray that also would be reversed some of these skin conditions that she's had. Let it be reversed and leave her body forever. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Everybody say amen.
Yeah.
Let's sing about Savior. He can move the mountains.
Oh, he's Savior. He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the Savior, he can move the mountains. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move all mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. Heroes and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Miracles over your life. Cindy Brandon Miller over there.
And then
And as we begin to pray for these needs, if you have a need, lift up your hand.
And
who?
Owen.
Not Owen.
Brown.
Brown family. Brown. Oh, Carrie Brown lost her husband. So
her son.
Someone just.
Her son.
Her son. That's right. Her son. What was his name?
Max.
Max. Oh my gosh. Yeah, he just fell. He had a massive heart attack. 49 years old.
No.
Carrie Brown. Lift up Carrie Brown. And our sister, Delina over here wants prayer. Somebody stand behind her and just speak the blessing on her. And we're going to sing this prayer, sing that chorus of that prayer again. Sing the chorus of that prayer. I pray for your healing. Father, we pray for all these needs in the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. Donna Hestis, Lord, we lift up Donna Hestis to you. Touch her today. Touch her today, Lord. Today, touch her, Jesus. Touch her. Touch her with your blessing, dear God. Give Lord strength for all that he's going through. Jesus. Lord, let circumstances change. Turn things around in our lives, God, where they're in line with your will. Where we're out of your will, put us in your will. Where we're weak, make us strong. Where we failed, lift us up. Forgive us and cleanse us. Take us through. Jesus. Pray for your healing. Yes, Lord, let the circumstances change. Let every fear flee.
Jesus, I pray that breakthrough would happen today.
Breakthrough would happen
today. Miracles over.
Let miracles happen right now.
Jesus.
Encourage you to remember that throughout whatever he has to talk about. He'll probably talk a little bit about Guatemala,
But I'm telling you, listen to the word this morning. Real quick, I mean, some of you have heard this before, but I'm going to say it again. My daughter and I went, I guess, I can't remember what year, 2015, 2016, we made a trip down to Guatemala on a missions trip. And there's a lot of things that stood out to me during that trip. You know, you've got memories and pictures that flash through your head, and a lot of amazing things took place. But there's one picture that I'll never get out of my head as long as I live. We went down into Guatemala, and we rode a bus ride, and we rode and rode and rode and rode and rode, and dusty and dirty. Guatemala, that was a beautiful country. And I remember getting this in a little village, and it's all built with cinder block houses and with metal roofs. And that's where Kirk lives, is down in this little village, and he's on the back side. Still the back side?
Yeah, still the back side.
And the Lord's blessed him with a nice place for people to come and minister out of there. But I never forget, my daughter and I get out, of course, if you know Emily, and she's working today serving coffee at Scooters. We got out, of course, she's a magnet to kids. And so she started playing with the kids, and we were there to... They showed us this building that we were supposed to do something with and paint and everything. And I'm looking at the building and I'm thinking, probably better to knock it down than do anything with it. But that's just the environment. That's just the life that's there. And so we're talking, and we've been now in Guatemala several days. And I used to be one of those people that said, if you don't speak English, why come to America? Well, I got reversed when I was in Guatemala because I don't speak Spanish. And my ears were so tired of hearing Spanish, not being mean or anything, but it just wears on you because you don't have a clue what's being said. And we were trying to figure some things out, and I had seen Kirk off in distance, but had paid no attention to him. Didn't even know if he was Guatemalan, American. I didn't know what he was. I just saw him coming down the road. And we were all trying to figure out how to paint a line in this building. And I don't remember. All I know is from behind, someone said, hey, is there anything I can do to help? And my ears perked up because this was English. And I turned around. And he's a little shorter than I am. I'm short anyway. But I turned around, and blaring in my face was a Michigan Wolverine hat. Now, those of you who don't know, I'm a very stout supporter of the Ohio State Buckeyes.
Yeah,
we're mortal enemies. Here I am in Guatemala, ministering the word, and here's this Wolverine behind me asking me if he could help. Have you ever heard of divine appointments? I mean, it hits me. Because a relationship built that day, I think he brought us some shovels and a level and maybe some water, that I had no idea why I was there that day, because he didn't stay really around that much, I don't think. I think he went back to your home, and we fearfully took the stuff back to his house because it's a whole different environment. And I'm walking down and there's dogs scary dogs. And everything's kind of dilapidated, and I'm trying to make it back to his house. And a divine appointment. Amen. And now, I mean, these years later, he comes up here on a yearly visits, comes here. And I want to encourage you. I don't know if you realize offering time's never over. These buckets are always here, but I'm going to encourage you. Bless him today with your finances. This is a great ambassador of Christ. I don't say that lightly. I've met a lot of important ministers. You may know what I'm talking about. They think they're important. They don't do much mighty work. But I want to encourage you to have ears to say, to listen to what he has to say, because he's an ambassador of Christ.
Amen.
He goes places. I may come and visit. He's trying to get me to come down in May of some of our children's thing. I may come and visit. I don't want to live there. He goes to places and does things that most Americans would be beneath them. He goes to the dumps and feeds the children. But he's an ambassador of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So when Pastor Ken said, hey, will you introduce him? Absolutely. It's my honor to present this morning to you, Kirk DeVinny. One last thing, in case he forgets. There's a table over here. Grab, he'll sell you some Guatemalan coffee, it looks like, hot sauce, and Bible covers. Amen?
He'll put gas in the car.
Gas in the car. Takes a lot.
Thank you very much, Brother Mike. Pastor Ken, I have a pound of Guatemalan coffee for you.
Hallelujah.
Come on up here and get it. You drink that stuff?
I do.
Okay, well, you know. You gotta. All right. And hang this up in the back room there in the fellowship. Brought you a Guatemalan flag.
Oh,
yeah, hang that up there in the back room and on the wall, and you can remember to pray for Guatemala. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, my brother.
Here.
Let's put it right there for now.
Okay.
Bring it back up the front.
All right, that'll work right there.
And praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I am glad to be here this morning. Covered about 4,000 miles since I left my home in Guatemala, driving. And still got another 10,000 to go before I get home. And my younger brother down in Bentonville, Arkansas, said to me the other day when I was there for 2 or 3 days with him and his family, he said, when are you going to stop doing this? I said, I'm only 69. What's your problem? I have no problem. Moving on down the highway. I enjoy the drive, so it doesn't bother me. I want to take a few moments and just, before we get into the Word this morning, I want to bring up to date on the ministry, what's been going on in Guatemala. You can take a look. On the right-hand side, we have some very current pictures, and we have pictures of our feeding center, the Manna for the Children Feeding Center, in the middle section. But we had a tremendous year. Things have been, in the midst of the pandemic, in the midst of things being locked down, and this year things changing again and coming back to normal. It was wonderful. We had to shut the feeding center down for about half of last year, and it was just required. We couldn't have the children come, but we reopened in January, and we're feeding. In fact, even today, right now, it is 10:30 in the morning in Guatemala, 10:15, and this is Day of the Child in Guatemala, and so today, there's a big fiesta going, a big party going on in our church in Culiacan with about 50 of the children in our feeding program, and they're being fed, they're being given Bible lessons, and they're getting a special, I think Pastor Hector told me they bought a piñata, laid it filled with candy, and all the kids will be getting a special gift as well, so this is a big day for the children in our feeding center down in Guatemala. And so we had a good year. We reopened the feeding center in January, and we're feeding anywhere from 35 to 50 kids in the feeding center itself properly, okay? And that's twice a week there. And then in the Tukulatan City dump, we have about 40 children that we have enrolled in our dump ministry called Manna Multiplied. We go into the city dump, and there we feed the children that live and work in the dump.
Amen.
They live right in the dump.
Amen.
They just...
Thank you, brother.
That is their life. That's their life. And half of these children are orphans. And they live in little tin shacks that they make out of tin or out of cardboard right in the dump. And we're able to feed them twice a week, a hot meal, and minister the gospel of Jesus Christ to them.
Amen.
The thing that started that was the Lord put it on my heart to do this other part of our ministry, feeding ministry. And I said, Lord, I don't have the money for that. And the Lord said, I didn't ask you if you did. You know, that's how God deals with things. He says, I didn't ask you whether you had the funds to feed these kids. I wouldn't have told you to do it if I didn't have things ready for you. I said, okay. And so we're feeding. And God is increasing and ministering to these children, giving them hope. In the midst of a hopeless existence, he's giving them hope.
Amen.
Halfway through the year, director of my feeding center, Pastor Hector, came to me and he said, Brother Kirk, man, we're just wearing ourselves out, transporting 2 days a week, food and tables and chairs, and the staff taking them to the feeding, to the dump to feed, and the rainy season starting, and what are we going to do when the rains are pouring down? And I said, just keep doing it, and we'll, so we rented a pickup, and we were transporting back and forth, spending a fair amount of money just on transportation. And all of a sudden, Pastor Hector contacts me. He said, Brother Kirk, I think we need a permanent place in the dump. I said, there's no facilities in the dump where we can feed the children. It's a dump. He says, well, I found a house that's at the entrance to the dump, and the lady wants to sell it. I said, really? He said, yes. So, 3 weeks ago, in a month now, because I've been gone for 2 weeks, a month ago, I drove out there, met with this lady, looked at this little house, got a big dining room about as big as this right here. It's got a little kitchen, a little bath, and a little room for someone to sleep in that we can put in there to be there all the time. And stepped out in faith, and I put $300 down on that puppy. And she said, well, when am I going to get the rest? I said, when God provides. And God is providing. Amen. And my goal is when I return home the first week of December, I will have the funds, just hand her the money, and finish paying for that new feeding center in the city dump. And there we will begin feeding children. Not in the dump, but just off the dump. They can get out of that filth, come into our feeding center there at the dump, just on the outskirts of the dump, get fed, get ministered to, and they will at least have that as a place that they can say, we're going to the feeding center right over there. We're going there to get fed. We're going there to get ministered to. We're going there. In February, I have a team coming from Texas that's going to do a medical clinic in that new facility to the children that live in the dump. Those kids have never seen a doctor in their lives. Hallelujah. Hundreds of them will come.
Thank you.
Hundreds of them will come. God provides. Amen?
Yes, he does.
Because he is the God of provision. He is Jehovah Jireh. Had a team come this year from Indiana. We did a clinic, medical clinic, in one of the mountain villages where we built a church earlier this year. 300 people came through that clinic. There again, they'd never been a doctor in that village. They'd never seen doctors. And they came. I have pictures of it over there. They came. 300 came. 8 hour ride in the van and then 3 hours by pickup truck up to the village. And God met the need.
Thank you, Lord.
God met the need.
Amen.
The van. I said, Lord, I'm spending too much money transporting teams, renting vehicles. It wasn't a week later, I get an email from a pastor in Indiana. He says, Kirk, we got a 15 passenger van that we want to get rid of. It's too expensive for us with the insurance. And can you use it? I said, I sure can. So they flew me. It's a beautiful Ford van. Gorgeous thing. They flew me up to Indiana from Guatemala. I got the van, transferred it over to my name, and drove it back home to Guatemala. And we do put a big old luggage rack on top of it, and God's been using it for missions for the glory of God.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
Sitting in the parking lot is my new little car.
It's a pretty car, too.
Pretty car. My Ford 500 gave up the ghost. The transmission went out. And it was going to cost me more money to get it repaired than it was worth. I said, Lord, I got to have a car. So what did God do? I said, Lord, I could use some money for a down payment on a car. I sold that car that wouldn't even run. Now, here's a car man. He knows cars. I sold that car to a mechanic for $1,300. That's gone.
Yes, it is.
And that was a down payment for the car, and then other churches, you guys responded, and I had enough money to pay cash for that little car sitting in that parking lot.
Amen.
That's gone. I mean, God does something about that. Man can't do that. But God can do that.
Amen.
So I ask you to continue to pray for the children in Guatemala for our dump ministry. I have three teams coming as of now for next year. One to do the medical clinic in the dump, another one to do a vacation Bible school up in a mountain village, and another one, I'm going to be riding a mule again. I'm going to an unreached village, a village called Kul, K-U-L. We bought the land, and we're taking a team up there at the end of March, and we'll go in there, and we will build a church in that village of 1,000 people, and they've never heard the gospel before.
Oh, hallelujah.
And I lost 20 pounds. I got another 20 to go. But I plan on jumping on that mule healthy and riding another mule ride up into the mountains. A little miracle in my life before we get into the Word. About 4 months ago, I was having some real problem with my knee. Okay? Knock on my door. And there's a pastor from down the road. Now, my pastor, pastor of the church that I know him, and one of the elders from that church, who's a friend of mine, he says, Brother Danny, God laid on our heart, we've come to pray for your knee. I said, praise the Lord. So just standing in my yard, we pray for my knee. I don't have any pain in my knee anymore.
Amen. The pain's all gone.
It's a little stiff still. That's okay. I played golf the other day. 18 holes. No problem with my knee.
What was the score?
God, don't be asking the score. You know, you crossed the line. To tell you, it was a 98, a 50 and a 48. Which I'll take for a 69-year-old guy with a gimpy knee. I tell you, God is good! If he ain't good to you, get into the goodness. He's good. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Okay, now, we're going to get into the Word. Turn with me, if you will, to John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. We're not going to read these. I'm going to take them apart a little at a time here. This is the portion of Scripture where Jesus has been teaching, and he's come out of the mountain, and he comes to the temple, and he's teaching, and they bring a woman called an adulterer to him. And they want to stone her. Mm-hmm. And before stoning her, they want Jesus' approval to do this. Okay? My favorite genre of TV shows are old westerns.
Amen.
I love them. I've watched every episode of Bonanza, High Chaparral, Big Valley. All of those. I've watched every episode. And a lot of old westerns you've never probably even heard of. But in those westerns, you'll always have this kind of a situation come up. The good guys, the sheriff and the posse, they will corner the bad guys, or they'll corner one guy, they got the drop on him, as they say, and they'll say this. They'll say, get your hands up, drop your weapon. Get your hands up, drop your gun. Now, sometimes they don't do it. And they turn in fire, and it's checkout time for the bad guy. But that line appears over and over and over again in those old westerns. Uh-huh. Hands up, drop it. I want to talk to us this morning. I want to share the word about a time that we in the body of Christ, we start dropping our weapons against each other in the church. We stop looking for reasons to accuse each other.
Amen.
To stone each other. Now, we don't do it physically with a stone like this here. No, we don't do that. We do it with words. We do it with actions. We do it with a look. We stone people. It's time that we drop our weapons in the church against each other.
Come on, make it hurt.
Because let me tell you, the world's got enough weapons coming against the body of Christ.
Amen.
Absolutely. We don't need to jump in on the melee and join in attacking each other. Look at verse 3 and 4 of chapter 8, John chapter 8. The scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery, and when he had set her down in the middle, they said to him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now stop and let that sink in for a moment. They must have been watching her.
Uh-huh.
Or they had sent a guy into her, particularly to set a trap. Because the trap was going to be Jesus. They were going to catch him. Now, this woman was taken in adultery. They grab her. They drag her. Throw her at the feet of Jesus. She might have been naked or close to it. I guarantee you they didn't say, well, go ahead and get dressed. No, they dragged her from that bed. Dragged her to where Jesus was and threw her down at his feet. And she's laying there, ashamed, feeling disgusted, feeling rejected, people staring at her. All these Pharisees and religious rulers and these religious people have got rocks in their hands and they're ready to stone her. They've got them ready. And they say, Jesus, you know the law. You know Moses' law. You're a rabbi. You know that we have a right to stone her. According to law, we have a right to stone her. They're waiting for Jesus to pass judgment. But Jesus doesn't pass judgment.
Amen.
He turns the tables on him. And he kneels down in the dirt and he starts to write. We've gotten hung up over the years. I wonder what he wrote. Wonder what he wrote. That's not the issue. The issue is further down. Come on, Jesus. Give us a little bit. Give us a little bit so we can judge her, please. We're locked and loaded. We're ready to nail her. You know the law. Let's get her. Please, give us the right. Give us the authority. You say you follow the law of Moses. You say you're a rabbi. Come on. I'm just waiting. So we can throw our stones. So we can throw our stones. Because more normally, good religious people, I said religious people,
uh-huh,
are good at throwing stones.
Absolutely.
And if you've ever been on the receiving end of those stones, it's not a picnic. Turn to me, if you will, please, to James chapter 4. James 4, 11 and 12. James 4, 11 and 12 says, do not speak evil of one another, brothers. Now there again, understand, he's not talking to sinners, he's talking to Christians, the church. Don't speak evil of one another, brethren. He that speaks evil of his brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and destroy. Who are you that judges another? Speaking evil is judging. We say, we see a brother and sister in sin, it doesn't give us the right to begin to judge them and to gossip about them. When you gossip, you're throwing a stone. When you go, look at that. Did you hear what he did? Did you hear what she did? That is stone throwing. And it is evil in the eyes of the Lord.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
It's downright evil.
Amen.
It's not just, well, they didn't do very good. You know, you shouldn't be. No, it's evil, the word says. When we see someone caught in sin, it should grieve us and drive us to pray for them, not gossip about them.
That's right.
Agreed.
The devil is the accuser of the brother, not you and I.
Amen.
When we accuse our brothers and sisters, we are playing into his hand. We're in his toolbox. It's unchristian to judge, and if you see something in a brother or sister's life, and you've seen it for maybe two or three times in their life, I guarantee you, the shepherd has seen it. The shepherd has seen it. And he will deal with it when the time is right and when the Holy Spirit guides him to deal with that.
Amen.
We're not called to accuse one another. As I said, if you've ever been on the end of that accusing, it is a hard road to hoe, being the one being thrown at the rocks. Regent University, I just got my master's degree, packing up the bag, getting ready to go to Africa. So excited, Mike, going to Africa. Going to live in Africa, be a missionary in Africa. And a friend of mine comes to me and he says, Kirk, he says, my home church needs a pastor. I said, oh, no, I've already done that. I am not called a pastor, no more. I've done that for 10 years. I'm off the mission field. Well, the Lord speaks to me and says, I want you to go check out this church. I said, Lord, but you told me Africa. Yeah, I know, but you're going to detour. I don't want to detour. I don't care. You're going to detour. I got my little Chevette, and I drove from Virginia Beach to Butler, Indiana, to a little town of 3,000 people with a church. A church that had gone through three pastors in 3 years, going from 300 people down to 25. They ate pastors like candy corn at Halloween. I mean, they just ate it up. They put me in the parsonage, and I was there for 5-6 days. And they were nice, and they fed me, and I went to their people's homes every night and meals with them and got to know the congregation. And I'm praying, saying, Lord, what message you want me to share with these wonderful believers on Sunday morning? Because, you know, I'm only a candidate. They want me to be their new pastor, possibly. I got to give them the best I got, Greg. I gotta lay it out there. And the Lord said, tell them this. You are an evil and stiff-necked, rebellious people, and if you do not repent, I will remove the candlestick from your midst.
No. Good sermon. Amen.
I was 33 years old. I didn't know diddly, let alone squat. I said, Lord, Lord, I can't say that to them. They will definitely not want me to be the pastor. They'll likely string me up. Give them that word. Sunday morning comes. I get in the pulpit. That's all I had to say. I looked at the people and I said, well, thank you for inviting me, and I have a word from the Lord for you. You are an evil and stiff-necked and rebellious generation, church, and if you do not repent, God will remove the candlestick from your midst. And then he gave me about 15 minutes more of stuff to say, and I said it, and I got down, and I sat down in the front row, looked down at my shoes, and I said, oh, Lord, please give them, just let me have enough money to go home and back to Virginia. That's all I want. They don't have to feed me. Just give me gas money. That's all I wanted. Heather Eller gets up. He recently went home to be with the Lord and became a very good friend. His name was Claire Immel. And Claire gets up and he gets up and he stands in front of the congregation. He says, well, I don't think we need to vote on this guy. I'm like, boy, you nailed that one. He says, I've been elder here for many years and I resigned this morning because I have lied to you as a congregation. There have been other men that have wanted to come and be pastor here, but I have weeded them out. Because I've always desired to be the pastor of this church. And I've coveted that position. And I repent this morning before you. Please forgive me. Just allow me and my wife to continue to worship here. But I resign this morning. He said, this man's our new pastor. And I'm like, oh no.
Please, oh no.
Lord, you play a cruel joke sometimes. Soon enough, I was the new pastor. Sure enough, I was there. And we were going along about 2 or 3 months in, and on a Wednesday night, we had a whopping crowd of 7 people. And in walked a whole family of 17.
There you go.
A mother and father, their 3 daughters and their husbands and all the little ruggins. 17 people. New, and they were tithers. Woo! Man, oh man, I was excited. For about a week, I was excited. Well, a little longer than that, but you know, they had an agenda, and I was naive enough to. Just be happy to have some warm bodies in the pews.
Sure.
I had a conference coming up, and I flew my new elders down that I had appointed. And one of the elders was this older man. I took him with us. We flew down to Florida to a conference with Pastor Paul Youngie Cho. And it was a wonderful conference. Pastor the largest church in the world, and it was a wonderful. We came back up and got back home, and about a week later, he stood up and he says, brother, he says, you're a false prophet. Da 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 da. And from there, downhill it went. Sure. Small town, 3,000 people. I'm getting gas at the gas station. If they saw me, they'd drive by and say, hey, look at the false prophet. They owned the town newspaper. Came out once a week. Took out a full-page ad in the newspaper. Denouncing me and our church. This went on for week after week after week. Month. 2 or 3 months this went on. I mean, I was dodging rocks that were being thrown. One of the elders got up one in the middle of the week, came to me and he said, Brother DeVinny, he said, we don't want you to preach Sunday. I said, that's fine with me.
Sure.
He said, we've got word that they're going to come to the service and they're going to stand up in the middle of the service and denounce you and publicly walk out. I'm going to preach Sunday morning, the elder said, and you guys go on over and take a little vacation. Didn't have to pray about it. I was in the car and gone for the weekend. Visiting a friend over in Ohio, Van Wert, Ohio, and laying in bed on that Sunday morning when I knew he was preaching and he was taking the heat. I'm laying in bed. I'm watching television. I wasn't going to any church. The last thing I wanted to do was go to church. You been there, Ken? Been there. I never wanted to go to church that morning. I'm watching TV, and who should come on but Gloria Copeland. And Gloria Copeland comes on, and she's preaching on that portion of Scripture where it says, when men despise you and speak all manner of evil against you, leap for joy. I hear that and I'm like, yeah, right. I don't have no leap left in me. There's no leap. She says, leap for joy. Then she says, hey, you pastor laying in bed. That got my attention. And I'm sure there was more than one pastor laying in bed that morning, not just me. She said, get out of bed. Leap for joy. And I stood in front of that TV in that bedroom of that brother's house. And she said, now leave. And I did this. She said, I didn't say take a bunny hop. I said, leave. Like a deer in the forest leaping. And I began to run back and forth. Leaping and shouting. Leaping and shouting. And the joy of the Lord returned to my heart. We're 40 miles away when this older gentleman and his family stood up to denounce the church. The head elder had a word from God and just spoke it. And they became convicted by the Holy Spirit and right there dropped on their knees and repented. The next week, they took an ad out in their newspaper renouncing everything they had said before.
Wow.
Now, that's repentance.
Amen.
If you've ever been on the receiving end of the rocks, that's no fun. So you, as believers, don't throw rocks anymore. Stop throwing them at each other. You're not called to do that. You're not called to look at that brother or that sister or that brother or that sister and say, well, look at what's going on in their life. That's not your responsibility. Your responsibility is to pray for them, fast for them, and let the Holy Spirit and the leadership of the church deal with it.
Amen.
Amen.
Drop your weapons. Hands up. You see, when your hands are up praising the Lord, you can't be throwing rocks. It don't work like that. Drop your weapons. Quit throwing them at each other. Look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5. Very quickly here. Matthew 7, 1 through 5. I know Matthew 7 is in here. I know there's a 7th chapter of Matthew.
It's right after 6.
I just got to get to it. There it is. Do not judge that you be not judged. For with what judgment you judge, you shall be measured, and with measure you meet it, it shall be measured to you again. And why do you hold the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not consider the beam that is in your own eye? Now, those are hard verses. We have to judge ourselves first. You and I, we know our own sins better than anybody else. Amen?
Right.
We know our sins.
Yes.
Right.
We know our faults. We know our shortcomings.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We don't need others in the church to be pointing them out to us. We know them.
Right.
We are to be helpers of our brothers and sisters' walk with Christ. We're not to be those obstructing their walk with Christ by criticizing them and attacking them and throwing rocks at them. That's not our goal. That's not our calling. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the great German theologian who was hung by the Nazis the day before the camp was liberated, he wrote this. He said, judging others makes you blind. Loving others and extending God's grace is liberating and will give you sight. Will give you sight. Grace, love, mercy to our brothers and sisters is where it's at. I was preaching in a church in Ohio and getting out of the car. Big old guy comes up on a big old Harley Davidson hog, and he's tattooed from here to here, wearing every kind of black leather and steel spikes and stuff. And he was the brother. And then he had another one that he was bringing to church that Sunday. First time this guy would have ever been in church. He brought him right up and he sat on the front row right in front of me. And I minister the word and I give an altar call. And I get done and they come to the altar. He brings this guy to the altar for him to receive the Lord.
Amen.
And I get ready to get down there and pray with him. Lord, Holy Spirit says, no, don't bother them. You go minister a little bit. Don't bother them. Let them, I'm dealing with that. So I go on down and pray for other people. And after about 15 minutes, I come back up to them, and service is winding down, and he's crying. He's been a Christian just a few minutes. He's just tears streaming down his cheek. I said, what happened to you? And I give him the microphone. He says, I got saved.
Hallelujah.
I said, oh, that's tremendous. What's that feel like? He said, it's the best blankety-blankety-blankety thing that's ever happened to me in my life. Had some old saints in the church just about roll off their pews. God wasn't offended by that.
No, he wasn't.
That was pure from that man's heart. That's the only language he knew. He'd only been in the kingdom 5 minutes. Some of you have been in the kingdom for 20, 30 years and you still talk like that.
Help us. Help us, Lord.
Quit judging each other. Quit throwing stones.
Amen.
Amen.
Please. The world sees us throwing stones at each other and it relishes in that.
Yeah.
It says, oh, yeah. They're fighting with each other. That's good stuff. In that verse 3 of chapter 7, it says, talks about the beam. You know, we use truth, and I'm going to be speaking tonight on biblical truth versus the world's falsehood. We use truth as a battering ram sometimes against our brothers and sisters. We say, well, our truth is the truth. Yours isn't. And I'm going to bang you over the head with it.
Right.
That's not Christian. That's not the gospel. That's not mercy. That's not grace. You'll never see Jesus doing that with people who came to him broken and battered and bruised.
Amen.
We're called to gently lead and correct a fellow believer who might be in sin. We're not called to nail them to the wall. We need to start by judging ourselves, examining our own lives. Sometimes we are very good defense lawyers for ourselves.
Oh, of course.
Oh, yeah. I got a reason for what I did. Hear me out. And we're also very good prosecuting attorneys against other believers.
Help us, Lord.
Oh, I saw what that brother did, what that sister did. Drop your stones.
Amen.
We are called to be ministers of reconciliation. We're given, according to 2 Corinthians, the ministry of reconciliation. We should have the spirit of Barnabas, not Pharisaical. We should speak of consolation, not of condemnation.
Amen.
In the same church I mentioned I was pastoring, a couple in the church came and came to me privately and they said, "Brother, Pastor, we have a son. He lives in Fort Wayne, that was about 30 miles down the road." And she said, can we bring him to church with us? I said, "Sure." "Well, you need to know something." I said, "What's that?" "He has AIDS." This was 1986, 87. And I said, "Well, of course, bring him." "Are you sure?" I said, "Sure." Because he's trying to go to a few other churches and they just reject him. I said, "You bring your son." And so the next Sunday he was sitting right there, two or three rows back with his mom and dad. And after the service, I don't know what I preached that day, who knows, I can't remember, many years ago, but I remember this. I'm standing at the back of the, at the doors of the church as people are leaving, and the mother and father come up, and I greet them and hug them, and the son is coming, and he's standing there for a moment waiting. And I just wrap my arms around him and I hug him.
Hallelujah.
And he breaks into a million pieces.
Oh, praise God.
He's just shattered. He begins to weep and sob. And this went on for two or three minutes, just rivers of sobbing coming out of him.
Sweet Jesus.
He said, you're the first person other than my mom and dad in over a year that has shown me any compassion, any love, anything.
Oh,
but condemnation and hatred.
Jesus.
He kept coming. Whether he received Christ, I don't know, but he heard the gospel.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to close with this. I want you to hear this. Drop your weapons. There it is. Drop them, drop them, drop them. Get rid of your stones. Quit throwing them at each other.
Amen.
You're not called to do that. You're not called to do that. We are called to show grace and mercy to our brothers and sisters in Christ. And you know, when a new believer, a new person comes into this congregation, for example, they don't want you to be looking at them like they're something out of Star Trek, out of Weird Things. Because we throw stones with our looks, with our eyes, with our words. God says, stop it. Drop your weapons.
Amen.
Drop them. I want you to bow your hearts right now before the Lord. I want you to hear this. We're going to sit here for a moment in silence. If you've been throwing stones at somebody, through thoughts, through words, through deeds, through a look, I ask you this morning to repent of that right now.
Amen.
Ask the Lord to forgive you of that.
Yes.
Say, "Lord, forgive me. I don't want to be a stone thrower anymore.
Lord, forgive us."
And I want to ask you to do something else this week. Through the strength of the Holy Spirit, the strength that we were singing about, go to that person and ask their forgiveness. Say, "Please forgive me. I didn't mean to judge you. I didn't mean to be attacking you. Please forgive me.
Amen.
I am sorry for that." I ask you to do that. Father, you know our hearts. You know where we are in our relationship with you. And Father, we don't want to be stone throwers. We don't want to be that person throwing stones and accusing our brethren. Because you're very plain and very clear. You say that is evil to do that. And Lord, we do not want to play into the enemy's hands. Please forgive us. Cleanse us, Father. Renew within us a right spirit, a right attitude. Renew within us an attitude of caring and compassion, of reconciliation. Let us be real ministers of reconciliation.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
To those in the body of Christ who are broken and battered, that have been bruised and hurt. Father, heal us where we've been broken and battered, where we've had stones thrown at us. Heal those wounds. Heal us, Father. Take away the bruises. Take away the marks of the words that have been hurled at us. And let us forgive that person.
Yes, Lord.
Who has done that. Let us have a spirit of forgiveness about us. Let us neither be the thrower nor the receiver of stones. We thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
That you don't judge us according to the law. That you are merciful and gracious and you judge us according to your everlasting love. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we thank you.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
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 Let me ask today, is there anyone here that needs to call on the name of the Lord and be saved? You're here in this service. Maybe you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. We don't want to close the service out without giving you an opportunity to come and pray or pray at your seat. And invite Jesus into your life, into your heart.
Yes.
Repent of your sins and just ask him to cleanse you. Is there anybody here today with uplifted hand would say, Pastor, pray for me today. I need to be saved.
Yes.
Is there anybody? I'm looking around and most of you, I believe, are born again. But there might be someone that is not right with God. Or maybe you're not sure you're saved. Is there anybody here that's just not sure and they want to make sure? Anyone? Hallelujah. Are there any saints in this room that feel a little bit convicted after this message today? Would you stand? Well, Lord, you see those that are standing, and I was standing. I'm going to sing this one time through. I know it's after 12, but you know, you're not going to turn into a pumpkin. You'll be all right. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter. I am the clay. My heart, oh God, make it ever true.
my heart, O God.
Bring something to munch on. Bring a pizza. Bring some sandwiches. Bring anything you want. We'll just eat in the back while he's preaching and teaching and eating. So we'll just have a good time tonight. See you at 5:30. And I love you guys. Thanks for being here today. You're dismissed.
Amen.
Coffee.
Oh, that's great.
Brian?